Hi there, Doug Stimmon with IT Creations with Dell's flagship server, the Dell PowerEdge R960. I'm quite sure a few extra suffixes for this platform are on the way, like for the R940, which also has the R940XA, and you can see one of those videos right here. I posted some links in the description below too. For now, it's just the R960, but what a machine! 4U, dual or quad socket options, flexible storage, massive memory footprint, and room for GPUs. If you like our channel, hit that subscribe button. Let's get to it. Did I mention this system supports 4th generation Sapphire Rapids Intel Xeon Scalable processors? It does, from the Platinum and Gold families. Hard to say if it will eventually be upgraded to support the 5th gen CPUs because it has been out for almost 2 years at this point. And they have the same socket. But we shall see. It's designed to support a number of high performance workloads including AI, machine learning, deep learning, plus support for large in-memory databases like SAP HANA, SQL, and Oracle. It can also be used for data warehouse, virtualization, virtual machines or VMs, and more. It'll take up to 4 double-wide 400-watt GPU accelerators and up to 16 terabytes of memory. A honeycomb bezel can be installed with either a security lock or a security lock and LED screen. Under the optional bezel, you have a number of storage configuration options including SATA, SAS4, Gen4 NVMe, and Gen5 NVMe EDSFF E3.S drives. EDSFF is Enterprise and Data Center Standard Form Factor drives and is supposed to be the successor to the U.2 2.5-inch form factor, which is what we have installed on this system. You know, better, faster, stronger, with a higher power consumption for better performance and higher storage density. Those EDSFF drives are much thinner too. Since they take up less space, this also allows for better cooling of the chassis. However, you can only install up to 16 of those or up to 24 2.5-inch NVMe Gen 4 drives with a standard 2.5-inch form factor, like on this review system. Ours is outfitted with 14 3.84-terabyte NVMe U.2 drives with a PCI Gen 4x4 interface. None of these storage configurations take up the entire front of the chassis. As both the top and bottom are typically divided into three sections, the most densely packed configuration with 32 bays still leaves the center section both top and bottom empty. Are you interested in the Dell PowerEdge R960 rack server? If you are, then for a limited time you can save up to $500 off a system that's listed or one that you can configure at itcreations.com that's valued at $5,000 or more. Every little bit helps. If you like the sound of that, click that link to learn more. When you're ready to make a purchase, just mention this video, itcreations.com. The left control panel has system health LED with integrated button that doubles for the system ID indicator. Next, a series of status LED indicators including LEDs for drives, temperature, electrical, memory, and PCIe. The system status indicator is also where the optional Quick Sync 2 indicator would go. Quick Sync enables you to access the Dell OpenManage mobile app using a smartphone or tablet with either an Android or iOS operating system. Quite handy and provides a wealth of information. The right server ear has the power on button with USB 2.0 port, iDRAC Direct micro AB USB port, and a VGA port beside that. Everything for your crash cart or laptop. Around the back of the system, you can see four 2400 watt 80 plus platinum PSUs with 2+2 redundancy for a 100 to 240 volt system. Power usage will depend on how the system is configured and will also influence the type of connector for your cabling. If you do go with loading it up with a full complement of storage devices and GPUs, you may need the full 2400 to 2800 watt PSUs. That last one, the 2800 watt, requires a thicker C21 cable as it is much more resistant to heat when drawing that kind of power. Think of the Death Star with all those cooling vents to prevent heat buildup. I mean, excessive heat kind of initiated its downfall. I suppose the R960 just has a fat cable and a bunch of fans. Whatever. That C21 cable is similar to the C19, but offers a significantly higher maximum pin temperature at up to 155 degrees Celsius compared to only 65 degrees Celsius on the C19 cable. But I digress. There are sensors all over the board to monitor thermal buildup, and the system can automatically adjust the fan speeds to compensate. Just like the front of the system, there are a few different configurations for the back of the system. No need to create a separate SKU for each of them, for which I'm definitely grateful. There is a basic configuration, scale-out configuration, maximum I/O configuration, and also one with optional liquid cooling. But for those configurations, we are basically looking at the PCIe slots and optional OCP 3.0 mezzanine card slots. There is definitely the mix and match option too. With the maximum I/O configuration, you can install up to 8 NDR 400 network interface controllers with a 400 gigabit per second data throughput. For scale-out, you might be adding multiple NICs for increased workloads and HBAs to access additional storage. All of them do have the same basic I/O panel along the bottom, with a unit ID button, LED light dedicated RJ45 management port to access iDRAC remotely, a USB 2.0 port, a USB 3.0 port, and a VGA port. For the liquid cooling option, it will take out that VGA port in the I/O panel for the lower motherboard. The panel just above has another removable panel for the liquid cooling input-output tubes for the upper motherboard. Optional is a serial port. An OCP 3.0 mezzanine card offers multiple connection speed and port options, depending on your needs. Ours came with a 25 gigabit Ethernet dual port SFP28 OCP 3.0 mezzanine card, but you can install one with dual ports at 100 gigabits per second. Beside that is another removable panel where an optional LAN on motherboard or LOM card connecting to the motherboard can be installed. Management of the system is at chassis using the optional QuickSync 2 with OpenManage mobile app, which uses Bluetooth for an at chassis connection. You can also plug in a laptop to the iDRAC direct port on the right server ear. Again, getting quick access to the management tools provided by iDRAC 9 Express, which comes standard on this platform. You can also upgrade to iDRAC 9. If you want more information on iDRAC 9 Enterprise, click that link. That dedicated RJ45 port on the back of the system provides a network connection for remote management of the system. Dell OpenManage Systems Management provides even more tools for managing this system and the rest of your network with an easy-to-use browser interface. There are a bunch of utilities for updates, integration with VMware vCenter, power management, and general whatnot. Let's move on. Inside the case, you can see ours is set up with a full-length risers and GPU shroud for support of up to four double-wide GPUs with a power draw of up to 400 watts each. Doing the math, you can install four, and that would be 1600 watts right there. If this system had those EDSFF drives installed, each of those also drains up to 25 watts of power, and at 16, that's about 400 watts. The NVMe Gen 4 U.2 drives installed on this system draw slightly less power than that. Still, it does add up, so plan accordingly. I will mention that to help you plan accordingly on power consumption, Dell does offer the Enterprise Infrastructure Planning Tool, or EIPT. That will help you calculate your power consumption and PSU needs. Getting sidetracked again. Once you remove the GPU shroud, you can see the top motherboard with dual CPU sockets and 32 memory module slots with 16 assigned to each CPU. To get at that, we also had to remove the fan cage and support bar, pulling the handle on the top processor expansion module, or PEM, with CPUs 3 and 4. It exposes the lower board with CPUs 1 and 2. It has basically the same configuration with dual CPUs and 32 DDR5 memory module slots for 64 DDR5 memory module slots across both boards. Also a bunch of PCI slots for PCI cable connections from the supported risers. There is a short list of Intel Xeon Scalable Platinum or Gold CPUs supported on this system. The CPUs range from 8 to 60 physical cores and 16 to 120 virtual threads each. That in addition to four UltraPath interconnect or UPI links at 16 gigatransfers per second, and 80 PCI 5.0 links per CPU. All told, it supports up to 32 to 240 physical cores, depending on your choice of CPU, and up to 320 PCI 5.0 links. Our system is set up with four Intel Xeon Scalable Platinum 8490H CPUs with 60 cores each, operating at 1.9 GHz with a 112.5 megabyte cache and a thermal design power rating of up to 350 watts. The H suffix on that CPU indicates it is optimized for heavy database and analytics workloads. They are paired with high-performance, low-profile L-shaped heatsinks. Supported memory includes DDR5 RDIMM memory modules up to 256 gigabytes. With all 64 memory module slots outfitted with those 256 gigabyte memory modules, the system can support up to 16 terabytes of memory. Memory speed is dependent on the CPU, memory configuration, and the memory modules installed with a top speed of up to 5,600 megatransfers per second with one DIMM per channel. Our system was set up with 64 DDR5 memory modules offering 4,800 megatransfers per second. Although to be fair, in a 2 DIMM per channel setup, memory speed is reduced to 4,400 megatransfers per second. There are four expansion risers and up to 12 PCI 5.0 slots total, depending on your choice of riser options. Three on top, risers 1, 3, and 4, with riser 2 below riser 3. The optional LOM and OCP 3.0 mezzanine card connection directly to the system board underneath riser 2. The riser cards plug into both the motherboard on the lower level and PCI cables connect to the processor expansion module on top. With the GPU risers and cooling shroud installed on this system, we can install up to four double-wide 400-watt GPUs. listed and vetted by Dell for installation in the system are the NVIDIA A800 80GB 300W GPU, A100 80GB V2, the A16 with 64GB of memory, and the A40S with 40GB of memory and a 350W power draw. All of these listed GPUs feature Ampere architecture. Since then, Ada Lovelace was released, and now Blackwell. So safe to assume Dell has not updated their materials to include the next-gen cards. No reason to think they were not working towards that goal by making the system capable of supporting GPUs with a power draw of up to 400 watts. Between Risers 1 and Riser 3, an optional boot-optimized storage subsystem, or BOS, can be installed, specifically the BOS N1, which supports one or two M.2 NVMe SSDs. The BOS is specifically used to boot the system without using any of the upfront drive bays. With two M.2 NVMe drives installed, the BOS N1 also supports a hardware RAID 0 or 1 for redundancy and resiliency. We removed the drive cables for simplicity, so you can see the backplane. There are 12 cable connections for the 24 front-mounted NVMe drives and a bracket for the front-mounted per controller or HBA. There are other backplanes to accommodate other storage options. The motherboard and processor expansion module, or PEM, feature high-performance heat sinks to keep the system cool, and are necessary with this GPU configuration. A number of PERC RAID cards for internal storage and HBAs for external storage are supported, but the system does offer the S160 software RAID option provided by the CPU. Two rear-mounted front PERC controllers can be installed on the drive backplane for rating SAS or SATA storage devices. Additional controllers and HBAs can also be installed for external storage appliances like the PowerVault ME5 series. I do hope you enjoyed this not short hardware overview of the Dell PowerEdge R960 rack server. It's highly adaptable to support a number of workloads, from AI to analytics, high performance computing, and database, to name a few. If you are interested in this system, check out IT Creations. If you want it, we have it, or we can get it, because we are partners with Dell. If you want more information on this system, I placed a few links below, or you can use that one right there, itcreations.com. Until next time, I'm Doug Steinman with IT Creations. Thanks for watching.